ঠিক আছে, জয়শ্রী
ওকে,
স্টার্ট।
চলে স্টার্ট আওয়ার সেমিনার। গুড আফটারনুন রেসপেক্টেড রিসোর্স পার্সনস, অল দ্য পার্টিসিপেন্টস, প্রিন্সিপাল অ্যান্ড মাই ডিয়ার কোলিগস। আই ডক্টর জয়শ্রী আচার্যা, অন বিহাফ অফ ডিপার্টমেন্ট অফ বটনি হলিশানি মহাবিদ্যালয়, ফিল অনার্ড টু ওয়েলকাম ইউ টু দিস ইন্টারন্যাশনাল ওয়েবিনার অন এক্সট্রিমোফিলিক মাইক্রোবস অ্যান্ড এনভায়রনমেন্ট। আই এম শিওর ইউ উইল ফিল এনরিচড উইথ নলেজ আফটার কমপ্লিশন অফ দিস ইভেন্ট। আই কনভে মাই রিগার্ডস অ্যান্ড গ্র্যাটিটিউড টু দ্য প্রিন্সিপাল অফ আওয়ার কলেজ ডক্টর নিপঙ্কর হাজরা ফর হিজ ইনিশিয়েটিভস টু মেটেরিয়ালাইজ আওয়ার মিশন টু অর্গানাইজ দিস ওয়েবিনার। I am thankful to the members of the organizing committee for their inspiring role in holding this webinar. I feel honored to welcome all the participants representing different institutions of esteem. The topic of the webinar has contemporary relevance in the stressful regime of COVID-19. Since one has to be deeply concerned with the life-sustaining system of the earth, the homeostasis system, that global environment is currently at stake due to irrational anthropogenic activities. Under the pandemic situation of COVID-19, there has been at least mandatory control over the attitude of man towards the environment and health. Worldwide, there has been a realization that the earth should be made green with plants, and the stressful event, stressful environment must be made comfortable. Restoration of traditional man-plant relationship is one of the only ways to optimize our environment. It must be remembered that the environment in which we live today is an outcome of its long-term evolution, collaterally with the evolution of the biological world. Integration of extremophiles with such a natural phenomenon of evolution for the last 40 million years or so has become a subject of study in the recent past, mysteries of which still remain unknown. Incidentally, an extremophile aptly claims to be an organism with optimal growth in environmental conditions, considered extreme in that it is challenging for a carbon-based life on Earth to survive. Interestingly, in July 2019, a scientific study of kid mine in Canada discovered sulfur-breathing organisms 7,900 feet below the Earth's surface. These organisms are even capable of consuming rocks such as pyrite as their regular food source. Many such unknown facts are getting unveiled and would continue to do so in the coming future. Today, our honorable resource persons would enlighten us about the extremophiles and their environmental implications, for which we have been waiting since so long. I would like to say a few words to all the participants that they are sincerely requested to mute their audio and disable their video during the entire session. You all are requested not to share your screen. If any questions arises in your mind, please text it in the chat box along with your name and designation. Relevant questions should be passed to the speakers by us only. I hope you all will enjoy this webinar. So once again, I welcome you all to the session, Thought-Provoking Lectures. Now I call upon stage our principal, Dr. Nipankar Hajra, to say few words. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Joyshree. Today's international webinar, extremophilic organized করেছেন বটানি ডিপার্টমেন্ট প্রথমেই আমি অভিনন্দন জানাচ্ছি আমার দুইজন বক্তা আছেন আজকে একজন ডক্টর অপর্ণা ব্যানার্জি ও ডক্টর জয়দীপ আচার্যিয়া তারা তাদের মূল্যবান সময় থেকে সময় বের করে এই ওয়েবিনারে এসেছেন তাদের বক্তব্য রাখবেন আমাদের এনরিচ করবেন এই জন্য তাদেরকে কলেজের পক্ষ থেকে আমি আন্তরিক অভিনন্দন জানাচ্ছি যাদের প্রচেষ্টায় এই ওয়েবিনার ডক্টর তৃপ্তি বৌড়ি ও তার সহযোগী ডক্টর জয়শ্রী আচার্যজি তাকেও আমি আমার আন্তরিক অভিনন্দন জানাচ্ছি যে টিম অন্তরিক্ষে থেকে এই ওয়েবিনার পরিচালনা করছেন তাদেরকেও আমি আমার অভিনন্দন জানাচ্ছি এই ওয়েবিনার বটানি ডিপার্টমেন্ট এবং খলিশানী মহাবিদ্যালয়ের আইকিউএসি যৌথ উদ্যোগেই হচ্ছে আমি যারা পার্টিসিপেন্ট তাদেরকে আমি আমার আন্তরিক অভিনন্দন জানাচ্ছি তারা নিয়ম মেনে থাকবেন বক্তাদের কাছ থেকে আমরা এনরিচ হব এই আশা রাখছি আজকের ওয়েবিনার সফল হবে সুন্দর হবে এই আশা করে আমি কলেজের পক্ষ থেকে এই ওয়েবিনারের শুভ উদ্বোধন ঘোষণা করলাম আপনারা প্রত্যেকে সুস্থভাবে এই ওয়েবিনার অ্যাটেন্ড করবেন এই আশা করে প্রত্যেককে আমার প্রত্যেক পার্টিসিপেন্টকে আমার অভিনন্দন জানিয়ে শেষ করলাম ধন্যবাদ
থ্যাংক ইউ ভেরি মাচ আওয়ার প্রিন্সিপাল স্যার ফর ইওর কোঅপারেশন And thanks a lot for wishing the seminar success. Now, the inaugural session is over and we coming to our next session, that is our first technical session. And it's my great pleasure to introduce our first plenary speaker, Dr. Apurna Banerjee, for this international webinar. At present, she is working as an assistant professor in Viceroy Korea, the investigation postgrado Universidad Católica del Mon, Talca, Chile. She is also engaged as principal investigator in fundacid initiation on bacterial exopolysaccharides as antioxidant and emulsifying agent. She has completed her postdoctoral research from the Universidad Católica del Maule, Talca, on analyzing the structure and functional diversity of exopolysaccharides produced by microorganisms from polyextreme environment of Chile. She did her PhD from the University of Vardhaman on the topic elucidating the structure and application of bacterial exopolysaccharides produced by thermotalin microorganism of Panitala hot water spring. Her total number of publication in Scopus journal is 25. Publication in other index journal and other chapter are 5 in numbers respectively. Total impact factor of her publication is 40. Truly, she has achieved so much at this very talented age. Her few achievements are Women in Biology Chair and core member of Indian Bioinformatics Society. She selected as Young Scientist Award from Indian Science Congress Association and in Young Research Forum at 10th International Conference on Nanomedicine and Nanotechnology in Healthcare, Thailand. She got Sharna Jayanti Puraskar for best presentation by Savitribai Phule University. She secured first position in research scholar extempore. Her membership of scientific bodies are like member of Chilean Society of Microbiology, member of India's Bioinformatics Society, BioClues. She has life member of the Indian Science Congress Association and Association of Microbiologists India. Now, I am requesting Dr. Aparna Banerjee to say her topic and enlighten us with her deliberation. Dr. Banerjee, please, over to you, Dr. Aparna Banerjee.
Thank you, everyone, and a very good evening to you all. I hope you all are doing well amid of the pandemic, the situation that we are facing all over the world. And thankfully, because if the situation would not have been like this, maybe I would not have got the opportunity to speak to you all. And I'm also thankful to the organizer of the event, and specifically Dr. Priti Bauri. She has been also my senior in the University of Burdwan, and it's very good to be in touch with the people whom we have seen during our PhD day. So I'm very thankful to her also. I'm going to present my presentation in a minute. Is it visible? Now. It's fine now?
No.
Right, it's fine.
Let me know if it's on the screen, please.
Yeah, it is showing on the screen.
Okay. So I'm starting my presentation. The topic of today's presentation is bacterial polysaccharides from extreme environments, characteristics, and scopes. I'm Aparna Banerjee, and I'm presently working as assistant professor in Center of Advanced Studies, Universidad Católica del Maule, Talca, Chile. And this background, the image that we are seeing, is a part of our university. So before I start, these are some of the views of our university. Some are taken, almost all are taken in autumn and spring, because in Chile, the change of autumn and fall season is very beautiful, and I like to take photographs, so I thought to share with you all some parts of the university in morning and also in the evening time. So, and you can see that some parts are very empty, because during the time of pandemic, almost the entry of the students has been restricted, and also only a few people are continuing working. While I'm also continuing my work in the laboratory, but only a few people have access, just like in India, the situation is same here too. So I will start with this slide, where I want to say that microbes are omnipresent. When we talk about the genera of life, microorganisms, plants, and animals, and we start with the prokaryotes, then we talk about eukaryotes and archaea. Microorganisms in prokaryotes, they are literally omnipresent. They are present everywhere, in all extreme temperatures of all extreme environment of the earth. And the all extreme environment can be a permafrost region, sea ice, cold sweeps, mud volcanoes, hot water spring, fumarolas, hyperacidic lakes, deserts, acid mine drainage, deep sea environments, hydrothermal vents, marine subsurface, some soda lakes, hypersaline lakes, nuclear contaminated sites like this. So when microorganisms survive in this kind of extreme environment, we basically call them as extremophiles. For example, if we talk about hot water spring, in hot water spring, nutrient concentration is low, species diversity is unknown, temperature is extreme, and oxygen availability is low. And all these kind of specific characteristics of one environment make it one unique extreme environment. So how we can differentiate it with polyextremophile? As from the name poly, it's understandable that the number of extreme factors there are more than one. For example, here we can see if, for example, in one particular environment, there is abundance of heavy metals, there is presence of solar UV radiation, and also, for example, the pH is extreme other than the extreme temperature. All these extreme factors make the environment a polyextremophilic environment. In the top, in the map, we can see Chile, and I have shown one picture there where UV radiation is high and the temperature is high also, along with solar UV radiation and abundance of heavy metals. And in the below, in India, that one picture I have shared here is Panipala, where I have worked. There is abundance of arsenic and the temperature is high. So we can see that because the country Chile is in polar region, the factors extreme have increased depending upon the environment, and we can call the microorganism surviving over here polyextremophilic environment or polyextremophiles. There can be different type of polyextremophiles. For example, one high altitude lake that have abundance of heavy metals with solar UV radiation with extreme low pH can also be a polyextremophile. Another example of polyextremophile can be microorganisms that are surviving in the extreme temperature of Antarctic region and they are near to one volcano, thus have the abundance of heavy metals and abundance of solar UV radiation. There can be another type in the soda lakes where there is high solar radiation and also the salinity of the environment is high. So depending upon the environment, the extremophilic condition changes, and accordingly we say them extremophiles or polyextremophiles. Here we can see one brief overview of in one nutshell, like how different extremophile can be called for and what can be their brief mechanism of action against the extremophilic environment. That can be acidophiles, can be thermophiles, can be halophiles, cyclophiles, UV resistant bacteria, xeric resistant bacteria, alkalophiles, and all of them work in different mode of action. Some works with chaperones, some work with dipeptidyl protein, some work with proline betaine, some with again with chaperones, and some with exopolysaccharide production. So depends different thing in different type of microorganism. But in general, one of the common mechanism to all of them is biofilm production. Here we can see one tree where we are trying to show among bacteria, eukarya and archaea, the three domain classification of life, in which classification, which type of extremophilics are surviving over there. As we can see, the domain archaea is mostly dominated by hyperthermophilic bacteria. The eukarya almost can be a little halophiles and some cyclophiles, and almost others are none. And in case of bacteria, we can see the most amount of tolerance. They are hyperthermophiles, thermophiles, cyclophiles, piezophiles, halophiles, pH extreme, radiation resistant. We can get almost all type of diversification in the classification of bacteria. When you talk about extreme environment, the research on extreme environment traditionally first came on 1972. On Yellowstone National Park, and this publication that I have shared over here has been almost the first momentary publication on extremophilic environment and its microbiology. when we talk about Yellowstone National Park, I guess we all know that the first thing that comes to our mind is Stack polymerase from Thermus aquaticus. This organism Thermus aquaticus was first isolated from one hot water spring of Yellowstone National Park, and we all know that it is regularly used in polymerase chain reaction, and it is also present in the COVID-19 detection kit as an enzyme. And the importance of this enzyme in microbiology, molecular biology, cell biology is immense. This is a way we can get an idea how to use the extremophilic, how to use the extremophilic environment for mankind or for human benefit. Then almost after 30 years, there was another momentary publication on Mars-like soil in the Atacama Desert, Chile. And this was the dry limit of microbial life. We know that Atacama Desert in Chile and some part of Bolivia also, this Atacama Desert is the driest point, the most abiotic point in the world. And for its much similarity of the environment and soil quality, there have been a lot of studies of Mars-like environment in Atacama Desert. So this have been another momentary publication on Xeric-resistant bacteria. Then recently in 3rd July 2020, I was just going through this, and I request you all to go through this publication of Improbable Oasis. And all the publications have been published in Science. So this was on microbial hotspot in a lake of Mexico, and how different type of extremophilic environment have enriched the growth of different microorganisms in one particular environment. They focused on that. So this is the way how in two decades almost, the research of extremophilic environment has changed, and we have come to know what are the different extreme environment of the world can help the or induce the growth of different type of microorganisms. When you talk about extremophilic environment, India is on the list definitely. There have been, in India, we can find soda lakes, we can find hot water spring, permafrost region. When you talk about permafrost region, we are talking about Himalaya. Himalaya is also called as the third pole of the world for its similarity of the extremity of North Pole and South Pole. Himalaya have four global biodiversity hotspots, crisis ecoregions. It is among the global 200 ecoregions, have many protected areas. They harbor permafrost region, many glaciers, hot springs, high altitude lakes, cold desert, volcanic sedimentary rocks. There is oxygen scarcity in this ecoregion also. And this is definitely an otherwise inhospitable environment. I have shared some of the publications over here related to that. One was from our lab and another was on the microbial side, microbial ecology of Himalayan cryosphere perspective. There has been not much work as compared to the Atacama Desert, or in terms of microbiology, there have been not that much momentary work like Atacama Desert or Yellowstone National Park or the Mexican Lake that we need to have in Himalaya. But the reason can be the extreme environment of Himalaya, and the roadway construction is also another inhibition to reach different ecosystem to get samples over there. But definitely, as we know that the third pole is melting, and for the global warming and the effect of climate change, there can be one point of time where we just lose the extreme environment, where we just lose this ecosystem, and we lose many important footprints of microorganisms. And before we lose, we need to know them. So the question arises, how the microorganisms adapt to the fitness? There can be different ideology behind how they adapt to the fitness in extreme environment. There can be loss of mutations, different protein stability according to the environment. They produce a lot of stress response enzymes. The membrane fluidity is different in different extreme environment, and they produce biofilm networks. So this biofilm network is important. Why? Because this production of biofilm is almost common in all the extreme environment. So when we are giving one environmental pressure, the microorganism is producing exopolysaccharide, and these exopolysaccharides or as we know from the term, it's a polysaccharide macromolecule. And because the microorganisms is producing it in its extracellular space, we call it exopolysaccharide or extra polymeric substance. What they help? They help, they permit adhesion of the microorganism to a substrate. Why adhesion is important? For example, one microorganism don't adhere to a substrate, there is possibility that the microorganism will be just washed through the environment. So getting one substrate for adhesion is important for the survival of the microorganism. And when they are adhered to a substrate, one surface, what they do? They form biofilm. And this biofilm give them protection against the stress factor like temperature, salinity, UV ray, different toxic compounds, can be antibiotics and osmotic stress like this. So biofilm, basically, the concept is like in extreme cold or extreme hot. For example, in the summer days in India, we prefer to stay in home and not to go out a lot. So in the winter days, what is the reason? Because the temperature outside is cold and the home giving us the comfort of living inside, not getting touched to that extreme environment. Biofilm is that protective cap of microorganism, where microorganisms survive under a home making colonies so that there will be no insertion of the extreme environment or the toxic compounds, whatever, and they can thrive against the extreme environment. As we know that presently, if we talk other than the extremophiles, in case of mesophiles or the medically important bacteria, the pathogenic bacteria, they also produce a lot of biofilm. And the reason is when they produce the cap of biofilm, the antibiotics don't pass through the biofilm cap because it's a toxic compound to the bacteria, and they thrive inside the biofilm protective environment, and the antibiotic don't pass through it. So these are some of the protective strategy of microorganism against different stress factor, and biofilm network formation is one of them. Among biofilm, the biofilm consists of different things. The main component of biofilm is polysaccharide or exopolysaccharide. They produce almost 60% of the biofilm is exopolysaccharide, followed by around 20-25% of proteins or glucuronic acid, uronic acid, this kind of compounds. And the rest 15% have some lipids and extracellular DNA. So basically the network of biofilm is a complex network that have polysaccharides, proteins, lipids, and some free extracellular DNA. And so through different precipitation methods, we can take out the polysaccharide part from the biofilm. There are different protocols of that. And why we want to take out this polysaccharides from the bacteria? Because these exopolysaccharides are of high industrial importance. As we know from here, the example that I have given, xanthan gum and gelan, this xanthan and gelan are regularly used in different food products. If you just go through some fermented products or some cookies and you see the contents of those in the back, you can see these are the products that regularly used in food industry for its emulsification capacity, thickening capacity, jellifying capacity. And you can see their applications are different in wastewater treatment, in oil recovery, in packaging, in coating, in cosmeceuticals, foods, pharmaceuticals, medicine industry as a drug carrier. Why? Because they have different properties. Their properties can be film forming capacity, structural biomaterials, emulsifying capacity, thickening capacity, jellifying capacity. They have different biological activity like antioxidant property, anti-tumorigenic property, hepatoprotective activity. They also have flocculating activity. And for all these properties, they are regularly used in industry for different applications. So as we are talking about, here we will focus on extremophiles based on extreme temperature. The temperature can be two types of temperature. It can be warm adapted and can be cold adapted, thermophiles and psychrophiles. In both these cases, According to DNA level, protein level, metabolites level, and in cell membrane, what can be the different changes? I have just shown it in a draft here. And we, in from our lab, we have also worked on some thermal stability related work and with some of my colleagues on the thermal stability of microbial proteins. So there we can get one idea what are the different warm adapted changes in proteins. As we can see here that the salt bridges, packing is more, hydrophobic cores are present, different chaperonins are present, whereas in cold adapted, it's different. There is peptide proteolysis, there are different reduction of antioxidative enzymes and cold shock proteins. So in both the extreme temperature, the methodology of the cell, how they protect themselves against the factors are very different. And here we can see one omics ideology, how the thermophiles basically works like a network. They have genome, they have transcriptome, and they have proteome. And overall, the entire setup of one microorganism, how they cope up with the extreme temperature. There is horizontal gene transfer, there is enriched disulfide bond, protein complexes, heat response, gene expression, co-regulation of the genes, and there is the base composition bias, mutation, genome reduction, and all this works like a network. As we can see in the right also, there are different stress that the thermophiles get, and according to the different stress, they produce different kind of they have different kind of modification inside the cell. They are thermophiles, but according to more different stress, they express different kind of mechanism. There are different metabolism of enzymes, there are accumulation of some nutrients, there is bioadsorption of the efflux pump, and there are some heat shock chaperonins, cold shock proteins, reactive oxygen species detoxification system. There is selective compatible solutes. So overall it works like a cellular factory or a cellular network that helps one single cell to survive in that extreme environment. So I will start with the example now, one that we have worked in my PhD. So we have worked in West Bengal. When we talk about hot spring, the hot spring that comes to our mind is Bokreshwar hot spring. There have been a lot of work on microbiology of Bokreshwar hot spring. But here we have focused on Panifala hot spring that is situated in Asansol, near the city Asansol, and in coal mine region. So in coal mine region, as we know, for the mining activity, there can be sudden out of geothermal expansion of hot water spring. And this Panifala hot water spring, the temperature, mean temperature throughout the year is 66.2 degrees centigrade, pH is 6.8. And the unique factor is arsenic. There is at least almost 433 parts per billion or arsenic is present in the hot spring. Earlier, there have been a report of arsenic-rich hot spring from Monikaran region of Himalaya, and the publication claims that to be an arsenic-rich hot spring. So here we can see this is a second hot spring that has almost 2.5-fold increase of arsenic than that of the Himalayan hot spring. The reason can be, again, the geothermal activity or the mining activity near that region, because it's a mining region. So here the temperature is extreme, and among the different stress metal, arsenic is abundantly present over there. So basically in this kind of environment, microorganism produced biofilm, and we tried to see how the exopolysaccharide macromolecule, because polysaccharide have carbon chains and this is a biopolymer, and biopolymers are regularly used in different applications. And for application, what we need to know is the characteristics of the biofilm or the polysaccharide. So basically around 8 g/L of polysaccharide was extracted from this bacteria when we substituted it with different carbon source and nitrogen source. And it was a low molecular weight exopolysaccharide, as we can see. And from the infrared spectroscopy, we have detected some presence of alpha glycosidic bonds. And when we saw in thermal stability analysis, we have seen the melting transition started around 276 degrees centigrade. So normally in case of mesophiles, the melting transition start around 260 degrees centigrade, but more than 260 degrees centigrade, the melting transition is for the thermophiles. Till now, there is report of one melting transition from Geobacillus strain from a Bulgarian hot spring, 294 degrees centigrade. And that has been the highest melting transition temperature of one thermophile in an extreme ecosystem. So the GC analysis, gas chromatographic analysis, confirmed the presence of glucose, only glucose, as the predominant monosaccharide in the exopolysaccharides. And from NMR, we have seen from 3 to 6 ppm, there have been different peaks for dextran molecules. And so because we have seen there is presence of alpha-glycosidic bond, and also it was showing from 3 to 6 ppm, different peaks of dextran molecule. And in GC, we had only glucose. So the only possibility was glucan type of polysaccharide. And in glucan, alpha-glucan, it can be beta-glucan or levan and can be alpha-glucan. Alpha-glucan is also named as dextran. So as we had alpha-glycosidic bond present in the FTIR peak, and we have some different peaks in from 3 to 6 ppm like dextran, and glucose was the only bonus monosaccharide present majorly in the GC. So we concluded this as an alpha-glucan or dextran type of polysaccharide produced by Bacillus anthracis. And this exopolysaccharide almost showed 3.5-fold increase DPPAs and ABTS mediated free radical scavenging property compared to the standard ascorbic acid. The exopolysaccharide also showed significant amount of emulsification activity against the vegetative oils like olive oil, sesame oil, some amount of rice oil also. And emulsification activity and antioxidant property is very important for a biopolymer or a polysaccharide to be used in food industry. When we have seen this, we have also tried to see its rheological property. Because in rheological property, what we do, we basically increase the temperature, and along with that, we increase the pressure. So we want to see how it's forming a gel. And this is important in food industry for the mouth watering or the viscous nature of a food or the fermented product. Because when we take a fermented product, we can feel a flavor or an aroma in the mouth and a sticky characteristic that is basically donated by the polysaccharides or the biopolymers. So here we have seen in pH 7 or neutral pH, it was showing greater hysteresis area following better structural reversibility. And the phase transition started at 72 degrees centigrade. So along with temperature and one particular pressure, it was almost stable till 72 degrees centigrade. And it was showing when we added sodium chloride in the aqueous solution of the polysaccharide, it was showing all solid-like character, liquid-like character, and complex viscosity, gel-like character. So basically, when we added salt to the polysaccharide, it was showing a thermoresistant shear thinning behavior that can be used in the food industry. So here we can see one example of polysaccharide produced by thermophilic bacteria for food industry. Different microorganisms are different, and their production or their secondary metabolite production is different. Another thing that comes to our mind, we are talking about Bacillus anthracis. So Bacillus anthracis basically is a pathogenic bacteria. How we can utilize the polysaccharide for our regular use. But extreme environments are very unique, and the microorganism surviving over there is very unique too. This Bacillus anthracis, when we got Bacillus anthracis, the first idea that comes to our mind is it's a causative agent of anthrax, because you know in 2003 there have been anthrax letter attack, and anthrax is a very deadly disease. With Bacillus anthracis, we know as a very deadly bacteria. That it is written in the book of Prescott that Bacillus anthracis is an obligatory pathogen. So when you got this microorganism, in research basically you don't have anything pre-bound that the result will be like this. And that's the beauty of science, that the beauty of doing research. So at that point of time, we thought of going through whole genome sequencing. along with the suggestion of my supervisor Professor Rajiv Bandyopadhyay from the University of Burdwan. And when we did the whole genome sequencing, we got to know that this is basically a non-pathogenic, thermotolerant and exopolysaccharide producing strain. From the genome signature, we got this idea, and the exopolysaccharide production part is already proved in separate studies. So that time, what came to our mind is the whole genome is showing the non-pathogenic properties of it that cannot be seen in other Bacillus anthracis that are available in different databases. So we want to prove it in mouse model. We want to prove it in the macrophage cell line, because Bacillus anthracis basically attack macrophage cell line. They grow inside the macrophage, and we had characterized different other molecular characterizations in the laboratory of Rakesh Bhatnagar in Jawaharlal Nehru University. Professor Bhatnagar is now Vice Chancellor of BHU, and he is one of the leading authority of anthrax worldwide. And so in his laboratory, we have proved that with the wet lab, along with the dry lab experiment, we proved it with wet lab experiment in animal cell lines, in mice models, that this has been a non-virulent variety of Bacillus anthracis. And this has been one first study. The polysaccharide that we have reported was the first reported polysaccharide from Bacillus anthracis. And this was also a first reported avirulent variant of Bacillus anthracis. So from this, we can have an idea that what can be the different treasure in extreme environment and what we can lose if we don't conserve them. Here I go with another example. So this was a Pseudomonas isolate from the same hot spring Panifolla. And because of its different property, we have studied the silver nanoparticle or nanoparticle synthesis, green synthesis of nanoparticle, which was showing antimicrobial property. Here, the melting transition started more. The melting transition started around 289 degrees centigrade, as we can see from the thermal stability curve. And the polysaccharide here was very different. Whereas the polysaccharide produced, dextran type of polysaccharide produced by Bacillus anthracis was separate lump-like structures. Here we can see that the polysaccharide is like a film, and it was showing a film forming capacity like a biomaterial. So as we went through the literature, we came through that this kind of characteristic feature in a polysaccharide are used in nanoparticle synthesis or green synthesis of nanoparticles, as they work like a capping agent to the metal nanoparticles. And here we have seen the presence of some alpha 1 C-glycosidic bond in infrared spectroscopy. In GC, we got some peak of glucose, and the another peak we couldn't identify at gas chromatography. But from NMR, we have seen that the monosaccharide, from the monosaccharide constituent analysis and the FTIR analysis, we saw from 1 to 5.5 ppm, there was different anomeric regions of rhamnose. And because there was presence of rhamnose, and also the presence of alpha 1 6 glycosidic bond with alpha 1 2 glycosidic bond, we concluded from the study that it was a rhamnoglucan type of polysaccharide. Pseudomonas is well known for its biofilm forming capacity, and Pseudomonas is very vivid in nature. There have been no reports of rhamnoglucan type of polysaccharide earlier from bacteria. Rhamnoglucan is reported from different plants, but here the Pseudomonas isolate was produced rhamnoglucan type of polysaccharide. So we produced silver nanoparticles using this polysaccharide, and it was a one-step preparation of or pot synthesis of silver nanoparticles. And as we went through the size distribution and its apparent zeta potential, we have seen that the apparent zeta potential was minus 2.73 millivolt, and the average size distribution was like 93.6 nanometer. So with both this value, we have concluded that these nanoparticles were monodisperse in nature, which is polydispersity index, and the average size of the nanoparticle was below 100 nanometers. So we can say that it is a nanoparticle, and the nanoparticle was relatively stable because it was showing negative zeta potential value. And here we can see the microstructure of the polysaccharide or of the Pseudomonas polysaccharide stabilized nanoparticles, and how the nanoparticles are embedded in the polysaccharide film. And so basically, and also with the electron diffractive spectroscopy in EDS, we have seen the presence of silver in the curve. So when we confirm the production of nanoparticles by this polysaccharide, we wanted to see the application. And this silver nanoparticle, as we know that silver has been used for a long in wound dressing during the world wars, and silver, there has been also report of using silver in Atharva Veda as a antimicrobial agent, and silver is known for years for its antimicrobial property. And this present era of drug resistance, when microorganisms are getting resistant to different drugs or antibiotics, there is definitely a need of studying alternative of antimicrobial compounds. And there have been a lot of study of using silver as an alternative of antimicrobial compound. Now, there is a lack. The lack is silver is cytotoxic in nature. And when we do the synthesis of silver nanoparticles in chemical mediated synthesis, what happens is it increases the cytotoxicity, because we are adding more chemicals to the metal, and it's increasing the cytotoxicity with addition of more and more chemical compounds. The benefit here is the cytotoxicity is less, because we are using only polysaccharide for the, there is no use of reducing agent, there is no use of another capping agent, we are only using polysaccharide. And because the polysaccharide sometimes have free negative charge, they produce metal nanoparticles, as they are positive in charge for that. And this, as the cytotoxicity is relatively less compared to the chemically synthesized nanoparticles, the biologically synthesized nanoparticles or green nanoparticles have a big expectation definitely from the researchers. And here we have seen that both, it was showing both interesting antibacterial property and antifungal property. The antibacterial property was good against both gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria, more in case of gram-positive bacteria, and it was showing some interesting antimicrobial property against fungi like Aspergillus niger, Trichoderma viridi. So it was showing one broad spectrum activity against different microorganisms, gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria and some fungi, indicating its antimicrobial or biocidal property. So here we can get another example how microbial polysaccharide can be used in different applications in biomedicine, in food industry. And here we can have one idea how microbial polysaccharide can be used in this particular example in the biomedicine industry. Definitely more works are needed further this. So in a nutshell, in India, when we talk about extreme environment, there is a big scope of extremophilic research. In India, there is Soda Lake, that is called Lonar Lake, we know in Maharashtra. There is presence of haloalkalophiles. In Himalayan permafrost glaciers, there are present of psychrophiles. In desert ecosystem like Thar, there is hyperaridity. In Baratang mud volcano in Andaman, there are presence of methanogens. In different hot springs, like we talked here, Panifala, there is presence of thermophiles. And in this era of global climate change and global warming, what we need to do is conserve the ecosystem and minimize the anthropogenic exposure in this kind of ecosystem. Basically, when we human go to one ecosystem and we leave our footprint over there, we lose the footprint of the microorganisms thriving over there for millions of years. We don't know when the evolution happened there, making that kind of ecosystem. So we need to conserve them before we lose them. Now I will go for another example of extreme ecosystem. My PhD supervisor, Professor Rajiv Bandyopadhyay, he has participated in Southern Ocean Indian Sector Expedition in 2011. And there is the map in the left of Southern Ocean Expedition. He has been the first one to work on microbiology of Southern Ocean Indian Sector. And they have reported around 57 bacterial isolates. And out of that 57, I have worked with 4 different bacterial isolates for their polysaccharide production capacity. When we talk about Southern Ocean, the temperature is less, so there is presence of psychrophiles. The salinity is high because it's a sea, and also there is abundance of different trace metals. So it is a polyextremophilic environment. And I will talk about the polysaccharide production of 4 different isolates, Pseudoalteromonas, Halomonas, Meridobacter, and Zonogonzia. So we along with our collaborators, our group have reported exopolysaccharide and capsular polysaccharide, both production by a Southern Ocean origin Pseudoalteromonas, and their thermal stability was higher, as we can see. They were showing different exopolysaccharide and capsular polysaccharide production when we change the carbon source and also the precipitating alcohol. It was showing more production of exopolysaccharide than that of capsular polysaccharide, but was producing both of them. Here we can see how both the exopolysaccharide and the capsular polysaccharide was showing its surface morphology compared to the standard polysaccharides like guar gum or dextran. And in the elemental analysis, we can see how it was showing carbon-nitrogen ratio, presence of carbon, nitrogen, and hydrogen. One important factor was sulfur. And as we can see, in the standard bacterial polysaccharides like guar gum and dextran, there was no sulfur. Sulfur was almost present in exopolysaccharides. And in marine bacteria, there is report of sulfated polysaccharides from them. And the sulfated polysaccharides have many different medicinal properties in different pharmaceutical and medical industry. The feature of the molecular interaction in the molecular bonds in this kind of polysaccharide was complex, as we can see from the infrared spectroscopy. So we couldn't determine further on that, but the presence of sulfated polysaccharides in the Pseudoalteromonas was a characteristic feature like the marine bacteria. We also tried to see one comparative production of exopolysaccharide among 3 different bacterial isolates, Zonogonzia, Meridobacter, and Halomonas. And as we can see, the FTIR peak was much complex than the thermophiles that we have studied. The reason can be extremophiles and polyextremophiles. For different extremophilic factors, the production of biofilm network is more complex than that of the extremophile. This can be the one reason why the network was complex in this kind of bacteria. And we can see that with different carbon sources, the production is different. But anyhow, the most production was reported from Halomonas, followed by Meridobacter and Zonogonzia. As we can see, its surface morphology, relatively, the surface morphology was same in case of Meridobacter and Halomonas, whereas Zonogonzia was totally different. Zonogonzia was showing more the characteristic of lump-like characteristic, separate lump-like characteristic, whereas Meridobacter and Halomonas was showing film-like characteristics. And as the CN ratio, carbon-nitrogen ratio has increased, the percentage of sulfur, presence of sulfur has also increased. The maximum amount of sulfur was present in Zonogonzia profunda, followed by Meridobacter and Halomonas. The significant presence of sulfur in the polysaccharide proves that the polysaccharides were sulfated type of polysaccharides, which is a characteristic feature of marine bacterial polysaccharides and can be used in different applications. So when we talk about psychrophile, it works in a whole, again, like a cellular network, everything works together to survive against the extreme cold environment, just like the thermophiles. So what are the factors here? They have increased flexibility, decreased thermostability, and increased activity. And for that, they have mobility of catalytic site, they have increased size and number of enzyme activities, they have increased hydrophobic surface, they have reduced core hydrophobic residue, just the opposite of the thermophilic bacteria, they have glycine clustering in the catalytic site, they have decreased interdomain and subunit ion, and increased ratio of lysine arginine, and reduced arginine proline, just opposite to the thermophiles. So in a whole, what they do EPS biosynthesis, carotenoid pigment biosynthesis, upregulation of the membrane protein, membrane transporter, peptidoglycan biosynthesis, regulation of lipopolysaccharide biosynthesis gene, and the membrane phospholipid adaptations are different. There are increased polyunsaturated fatty acid in this type of cyclophiles. There are lipid class composition different, and the charge of the lipid head is different, and the regulation of the flagellar motility is according to the extremophilic environment or the cyclophilic environment. So as we talked up something about the Indian environment and the extremophiles, and also in Indian sector, Southern Ocean, I will just give a brief idea about the work that I'm doing in Chile. Presently, the fund that I am having here now is a Fondesit Initiation Fund. And as we can see, Chile, it's in the southern hemisphere, and we are staying, as we have shown in the map, we are staying in Maule, just in the middle of Chile. And the Chile from north to south, if we think about Chile, is just the opposite of India. In India, the north is extreme cold and the south is extreme hot. If we just opposite this Chile, the north Atacama Desert is extreme hot and abiotic, and the south is permafrost and extreme cold. So Maule region, from north to south, is of Andes Mountain, and in Andes Mountain, there are presence of more than 400 active volcanoes in Chile. For that, almost like every week we feel, or almost every day we feel some little earthquakes. Earthquakes here are very common, and like more than less than six, they in Richter scale, they even don't measure it as an earthquake. So when I remember when I first arrived in Chile, and I used to like fear in little earthquakes, they don't even call that earthquake. They have a different term of this little earthquakes here, and they don't get fear. The houses over here are very are earthquake proof, and they are different in how they make it. So because of the presence of volcano, there are present of volcanic lakes, there are present of different hot water spring around Chile from north to south, and all entire Chile have Andes Mountain. In Maule region, towards the eastern region, we have Andes Mountain, and in the Andes Mountain, as I have showed, we are presently working in three different hot springs. And the factors over here are temperature is extreme, presence of UV, because in the southern hemisphere, there is presence of ultraviolet ray, and the presence of different trace metals because it's in volcanic in origin. So how this is one hot spring that it looks, how the second one looks, and how the third one looks. How they look is completely different than the Indian hot spring. Mostly in India, I have seen the hot springs have the presence of algal material near it. The reason why there is no algal material in these hot springs can be the pH is acidic. And because of the acidic pH, in this kind of environment, presence of algae is not that much observed. The color of the biofilm is very different, and the color of the biofilm is very vivid also. So in general, they are acidic, low chlorine and sulfate rich hot spring. The high conductivity and high dissolved solid content indicate several metal ions and organic matters present in the site. Presently, we are working with three different polysaccharides, and three of them are very unique from three different sites. And the project is just now finishing the first year. It was very different and difficult to execute the project this year, because I got the project. It's like in India, CSIR or UGC project like that. Here the government project is Fondesit project. And difficult part was in November the project start, and then February is a holiday. in Chile, and from March the coronavirus cases starts, and when the coronavirus cases start, it was very difficult to reach to the mountain, because in mountain these are remotely located, but the problem is almost the roads were closed in every part, and we have to walk a lot in the mountain to get the samples, and the mountains are not like India, it's there is no road, so we just walked in the, we had trekking in the mountain. It was difficult, but it was a very good experience of how to get the samples in a ecological way without disturbing the environment. And a very good thing that I observed in March when I got the sample, because I have also went to this hot spring before this, and all the time I have seen that the people going over there and they are sitting near the hot springs and getting the water vapor. The temperature is very high for that, taking bath is not common here. But this time when I went, there was almost no one. And how we can see the hot springs, it was just pristinely located and there was no one near the hot springs. That moment of time, we have what, as a conservationist point of view, I thought that maybe one race, human race, is affected by this pandemic, but the world is breathing. But the world is breathing after a long time. And the world does not belong to only the human. It belongs to us all, every genera of life. When we talk about conservation, we mostly talk about human, animal, and plants, and talk very less about microorganism. But the earth belongs to us all. And because of pandemic, the world takes a halt, but the other classes of life are taking breath after a long time. So in Chile, basically, there. Chile is can be talked like one model ecosystem for study of extremophilic environment. There is hot springs like Lirima, thermophiles. There is desert ecosystem, Atacama Desert, and known for its hyperaridity. There is Soda Lake, Salar de Huasco, Salar de Atacama, known as for its haloalkalophiles. There is Geyser and Fumarolas. Very famous is El Tatio for hyperthermophiles. Chilean Patagonia or Antarctica is famous for its psychrophiles. And these are the different ecosystems, how they look. Definitely, we need to conserve them before we lose them. So basically, I will end up my slide with two more slides on conservation. When we talk about the life, there is bacteria, general. There is bacteria, archaea, plantae, fungi, and animalia. And all these things, when we talk about conservation, we focus on the eukaryota. We don't talk about prokaryota that much. We very less talk about archaea. We talk about bacteria at like 1% and archaea nothing. Why nothing? Because symbiosis with plants, when we talk about bacteria, mostly we talk about bacterial symbiosis, rhizobiums with plants and how they help in nitrogen fixation. So our point of view in conservation is like very beneficial point of view of conservation. This is just my ideology, what I have seen all these days. When we talk about conservation of microorganism, we think how they are helping the human. But basically, if we see in a general point of view, microbes are helping in that particular ecosystem, maintaining the ecosystem, and also helping in biogeochemical cycle around the world. And in the present, a time of, as I have earlier also talked, in this present time of climate change and global warming, if we lose one extreme ecosystem and also for human footprint, we will lose one important footprint of microorganism, and the impact on the world can be deleterious. So when we talk about conservation of microorganism, the first publication that came was in 1964, and this publication officially talked on conservation of microorganism, but the paper basically talks about conservation of microorganism or cultivable microorganism. So it talked about cell collection centers, and we know around the world now we have a lot of collection center. In India, there is in Pune, MCC Pune, there is in IMTEC Chandigarh, there is in there are some Uttar Pradesh, and there are different culture collection center in the world. There is also different culture collection center in different countries. So this was the first publication that talks about culture collection. Then there was a big gap from 1964 to 2019. There was almost no publication. in 2019, one publication came on conservation biology needs a microbial renaissance, a call for consideration of host-associated microbiota in wildlife management practice. So they talk in general about the microbiome in the management, wildlife management. So when we are talking about the management of plants and animals, we need to talk about the host-associated microbiota too. So what about the microorganisms that are not host-associated? We need to conserve them also. So we basically communicated one publication on the emergent climate change impact throughout the world and how microbiome conservation is needed before it's too late. But definitely, we need to talk more about the conservation of microorganisms, and we need a holistic approach. Basically, throughout the world, in different biodiversity hotspots, there is the need of conservation of microorganisms. Why we call them biodiversity hotspots? Because they are rich in biodiversity, but they are threatened. They are threatened for human impact. They are threatened for the climate change impacts and global warming. This is the reason they are called as biodiversity hotspot. Around the world, presently there are 36 biodiversity hotspot, and India have 4 of the biodiversity hotspot in it. Out of them, Eastern Himalaya is one of the biodiversity hotspot, and Sikkim is completely Himalaya locked country, and there is urgent conservation need in this biodiversity hotspot, in different biodiversity hotspot of India. So basically, we need one integrative conservation management. When we talk about conservation, we need to have host-associated microorganisms that bridge the conservation biology and microbiome study. And we need plant and animal conservation along with microbiome conservation. Recently, 17 September was International Microorganism Day. And the focus of International Microorganism Day, one of the focus was the conservation. So I will end up my slide with this. I am thankful to Universidad Católica del Maule and Center of Advanced Studies. I am thankful to Fondesit, to Center of Biotechnology, UCM. I am thankful to Bardoan University for part of my PhD research work, and Ministry of Earth Sciences, Government of India for the Southern Ocean Expedition. I'm also thankful to BioClose organization and Society of Microbiology Chile. With both of them, I am attached. And I will end up with this quote of Rosalind Franklin: science and everyday life cannot and should not be separated. Science for her was like a partial explanation of life to her. And in so far as it goes, for her, it was experience and the experiments. So for her, the life experience and the science experiments work together. It was based on these facts. This is beautiful how one scientist incorporated science in her basic life. So I will end up my presentation with this, and I'm open to question. So if you have some question, you can ask me.
Thank you very much, Dr. Aparna Banerjee, for your nice deliberation about bacterial polysaccharides, their characteristics and conservation. And I also thanks for giving us your valuable time with your busy schedule. I am indebted to you. Thanks, Aparna, once again. And now I am requesting Dr. Joyashree Acharya to start our interaction session. Joyashree, Please ask some selected questions.
Thank you, Dr. Baudi. We all are daily enriched with her presentation. So here is an interrogative session. And here is a question. Here is a question from a student, a BSc honor student. He was asking, could extremophilic prokaryotes have developed on other planets in the absence of the evolution of a more generally distributed species?
Okay, so in exobiology point of view, basically there have been a lot of works on the spaceship. There have been works on samples are taken from spaceship, and there was presence of microorganism in the outer surface of the spaceship. There have been presence of microorganism in Mars-like soil and Mars soil. So basically microorganisms survives in different extreme environment, and we as a human have different boundaries, and we could not go through the other planets to have an idea what life is surviving over there. But recently we are like more interested about in Venus, because some days back there was some presence of characteristic feature of the presence of microorganism in Venus environment, and the world is talking about a lot of exobiology, possibility of exobiology in Venus. And as a microbiologist, I believe there can be different life forms present over there, but definitely we have some hindrances, because we cannot take samples from there and we cannot get to know what life is surviving. But there is possibility, because in science you cannot say no or you cannot say yes. Everything can have different aspect until and unless we are really going through it.
Exactly, ma'am. Now what is the time required for dialysis of polysaccharides?
Okay. This actually depends. For the dialysis of polysaccharide, it depends. For example, when I was doing the dialysis in India, we were making the dialysis for 24 hours. But here, I am purifying the polysaccharide in some other method also. I have modified the production. So if we just reduce the impurity from the polysaccharide with separate other precipitating agents for protein impurification, separation of proteins and others, in overnight this can be done. But it depends upon the polysaccharides. So cannot be like this hour. It's not like this.
Okay. Does bacteria produce exopolymeric substances?
Yes. Basically, exopolysaccharide or extrapolymeric substances, these both are called the same. Why exopolysaccharide? Because this is polysaccharide in nature and they are extracting it out to the extracellular environment. Thus, these are called exopolysaccharide. But it's not only the polysaccharide. The majority of it's polysaccharide. 60%, around 60% is polysaccharide, followed by some amount of proteins, lipids, and free extracellular DNA. So we also call it an extrapolymeric substance. Polymer, because there are different kind of macromolecules and they are excreting it out to the extracellular environment. So it's called an extrapolymeric substance. But the acronym is EPS. Exopolysaccharide, EPS. Or extrapolymeric substance, EPS. But both are same, just the ideology is different, only this.
Oh, okay then. And now the last one is, how can one get more better pictures for capsules polysaccharides from bacterial sample in light microscopy?
Okay, for capsular actually, it's not only the capsular polysaccharide in light microscopy, but congoed in general, congoed staining and Alcyon blue staining can be done to because only capsular polysaccharide, they will not stain. You have to, when they are producing capsular polysaccharide, they can also extract out some polysaccharide in the extracellular environment. Some loosely bound slime layer can be there. But in general, the production of polysaccharide can be detected in light microscopy using congoed and Alcyon blue staining. And the protocols are there. These are very easy protocol and can be followed to see.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. It was nice talking to you. One more question is there. That is from Shagot. Sorry.
I think it's Shagota.
Shagota. The question is, what on Bacillus anthracis is remarkable? Is your publication on the same can be accessed?
Yes. This is the one of genomics is a freely accessible work. Just cite Bacillus anthracis PFAB2 with my name in Google Scholar. These all publications are available over there. So it can be accessed.
Okay, thank you so much, ma'am. Now, I call upon the platform, our convener, Dr. Baudi. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Joyashree, for this nice interaction session. Now, we are in our second technical session. Our second distinguished speaker is Dr. Jaydeep Acharya, and I am very much honored to introduce him with you. Dr. Joydeep Acharya completed his BSc in Botany from Hubli Mohanlal College and MSc from Baligon Science College. He did her PhD from the University of Bardhaman in the topic Taxonomic Studies on Captifoliaceae in India. Dr. Acharya joined as an assistant professor of botany under West Bengal Education Service at Darjeeling Government College. And at present, he is working as an assistant professor in Kalna College. His total number of publications in national and international journals is 8, and his book chapter is 3 in number. Some best achievements in his life are: he was selected for an award under the National Merit Scholarship Scheme at the Government of India. He awarded with the Dr. S.N. Banerjee Gold Medal by Indian Mycological Society. Now, I call upon Dr. Joydeep Acharya in this session to engage us on the topic of surveillance on diverse man-plant relationship in context to conservation of environment. Over to you, Dr. Joydeep Acharya. Please, sir.
Thank you, Tripti ma'am. Is my screen is visible?
Yes, it is visible, sir.
Okay. So, good evening, everyone. Thank you, the organizers, for giving me opportunity to speak in this forum. Before starting my topic, I'd like to convey P. Puja greetings to all the participants, as because the largest festival of Bengal is just knocking at the door. And I would also like to wish everyone a very safe and happy Puja. Now, coming to my topic, it's a survey work entitled Surveillance on Diverse Man-Plant Relationship in Context to Conservation of Environment. So before going to the topic, we must know what is an environment. Environment is the surroundings or conditions in which a person, animal, or plant lives or operates. Broadly, it can be defined as the circumstances, objects, or conditions by which one is surrounded. The complex of physical, chemical, and biotic factors like climate, soil, living organisms that act upon an organism or an ecological community and ultimately determines the form and survival of the organism. So, at present day, conservation of environment is a challenging issue. Everyone is concerned with restoration and conservation of environment. There is no doubt that the environment is day by day getting worsened. So, how can we conserve the environment? It's a big question. There are many scientific approaches for conserving the environment, conserving the planet, conserving the bioresource, conserving the earth. There are many socio-political approaches to conserve the environment. But after making a survey, I can say that we can conserve the environment definitely by loving the nature and conserving biodiversity. If we can love the nature, automatically our awareness will grow up, and we will be eager to conserve the nature and conserve everything that restores the nature. Now, my work is based upon a field work in tribal areas for documentation of primary data through interviews, definitely, which is followed by cross-checking of the collected information. This is the primary part of the work. And the secondary part is the scrutiny of ancient literatures, manuscripts, sculptures on forts, temples, paintings, documentation and analysis of folklore, songs, beliefs, taboos, magical religious practices, drawings, paintings. The third part is study of plants and plant parts recovered from archaeological sites, study of fossilized plant materials, study of herbarium specimens. And the fourth part, it is a thorough survey of the local markets to document the wild edible plants and plant parts, and also the study of different ceremonies and festivals, rituals, to work out the relevant cultural practices. And obviously, documentation of the traditional knowledge, that is the knowledge of the indigenous communities, must concern stock taking of biodiversity and bioresources for their sustenance and conservation. So after the survey, I have found out five types of man-plant relationship. The first one is the relationship which is both useful to man and plants. We all know the first one is oxygen and carbon dioxide balance. That is, the carbon dioxide released by the man and all the other animals by respiration is taken up by the plants for their photosynthesis. In return, they give us food and release oxygen. And this oxygen is also taken up by the animals for respiration to release the carbon dioxide. The next one is agriculture and horticultural practice, by which the plants are propagated, conserved, nurtured by the human for their benefit of food for commercial purpose. As a result, both are benefited. And the third one is the application of genetic and scientific procedure for increasing the reproductive capacity and survival of the plants. That increases the vigor of the plants, that increases the reproductive capacity of the plant. Thus, the plant is benefited and the man is commercially benefited. The fourth one is anthropochory. And the last one is domestication of wild plants. Man has domesticated wild plants from the ancient times, and thus these plants are propagated in huge number by the man. The next relationship is the relationship useful to man but harmful to plants. Yes, there are some relationships which are by which the man is benefited but the plants are harmed. The first one is selective use of plant species. For commercial benefit, man is using and cultivating particular plant species. As a result, there is a loss of germplasm diversity. Certain plants are becoming threatened and even extinct. The second one is monoculture forestry, which involves plantation or cultivation of a particular tree species for artificial plantation. That leads to loss in biodiversity. The third one is agricultural care specializing plants. By overcaring the plants are losing, particularly the agricultural crops are losing their vigor. And the fourth one is over exploitation of plant resources, excessive lodging, excessive lumbering, habitat destruction, and all these. The third relation, relationships useful to plants but harmful to man. Yes, there are also some relationship exists where plants are benefited, but man is harmed. The first one is definitely spread of obnoxious weeds like Parthenium, Lantana camara. All these plants are spreading in rapid rate, which causes harm to man. The next one is use of biocides such as herbicides, insecticides, fungicides, which not only kills the unwanted plants, unwanted microorganisms, but they also kill the good living organisms of the soil. The third one is biopollution created by several spores and pollens which are allergic to human. Some seeds also cause several diseases to man. The fourth one is the relationship which is harmful to both man and plant. First and foremost, in this relationship is pollution. We all know air pollution, water pollution, soil pollution causing climate change, particularly air pollution, where both man and plants are harmed. Second one is deforestation, which causes environmental change, change in climate, where both men and plants are harmed. Third one is shifting cultivation, which was a practice among the tribals where they slash and burn a particular place to make the soil, to use the soil for few years, and they all used to leave the place and shift to some other places and practice the same, repeat the same practice. This causes harm both to plants of that place and man. And the last one is the major environmental challenge, which is the greenhouse effect, acid rain, where both plants and man are harmed. And the fifth one is the most interesting one, is the relationship based on cultural and spiritual activity. Yes, there are some relations, and it is the most interesting, I feel. It includes, there are several plants which are directly worshipped by man, such as banyan tree, tulsi tree, which are still now worshipped even in the cities. Second is the plant parts offered in worship. It includes leaves of some plants like mango plants, bale plants, wood apple, flowers, twigs, etc. Third one is faith and taboos, prohibitions. Fourth one is sacred groups. And the fifth one is plant and plant parts used in festivals and ceremonies. In our upcoming Durga Puja, banana plant is worshipped. Now, these are the pictures of some sacred groups from different parts of India, where the entire ecosystem of that place is conserved. These are some more pictures. And my work revealed two categories of man-plant relationship. First one is materialistic, that includes food, fodder, fibers, herbal medicines, timber, household and building material, and other resources. And the next one is cultural, which is based on emotion. It includes faith, festival, taboos, rituals, social activities. Now, if we come to the utilitarian land-plant relationship, man uses plants for food, shelter, garments, fibers, toxins, weapons, and tools. The aesthetic man-plant relationship includes use of plants in art and craft, use of plants in sculpture, for landscape designing and gardening, for house decorations, for wall paintings. Plants are used in cosmetics, in making tattoos. The conservational man-plant relationship includes domestication and selection of useful plants and animals, consideration of some plants and animals to be sacred and their worship, dedication of forest to supernatural powers. And there are lots of prohibitions and taboos which are concerned for conservation of the nature and ecosystem. Now, these are the pictures of some ethnic people that show direct man-plant relationship for their livelihood. One lady is making plates from sal leaves, which are still now used in our society. Another one is a basket making from bamboo plant. These are the pictures that shows livelihood dependent on bioresource through direct man-plant relationship. These products are made without any processing and industrial specialization. These are also some pictures that showing livelihood dependent on bioresources. Now, if we consider the use pattern of higher plants in India, more than 15,000 species are used by the Indians, of which nearly half, that is 7,500 species, are used for medicinal use. And among these plants, 950 species are fit for commercial use. With the Indians use 3,900 species of plants for food, and commercially we use 200 plant species. 525 species are used as fiber, of which 50 are commercially exploited. There are also some plants which are used as fodder, nearly 400 species, for pesticidal use, 300 species. As a source of gum, resin and dye, 300 species. As a source of perfumes and incense, 100 species. And for cultural use, about 700 plants are used. And if we categorize the plant on used base categories, we use 521 plant species as leafy vegetables. We use the roots and tubers of 145 plant species, flowers and buds of 101 plant species, fruits of 647 plant species, seeds and nuts of 110 plant species. And now, the decade beginning from 1st January 1995 is observed as the international decade for the world's indigenous people. About 300 million people, that is 30 crore out of 700 crore, that is one in every 20 or 23 people of the earth belong to indigenous culture. And interestingly, nearly half of them lives in Asia and mostly in China and India. In India, the indigenous communities are called as tribes. And in India, there are nearly 68 million people, that is about 7 crores of people belonging to 576 tribes. These are the places which are rich in the dense, which are the rich in the, what else, which are rich in ethnic peoples. One is all over the sub-Himalayan region and the mountain valleys of Northeast India. Another one is the hill and plateau between Godavari and Narmada rivers from Santhal Parganas to Rajasthan, descending to Hyderabad in the south. Another one is the Andaman and the Nicobar Island. And the fourth one is the southernmost part of the Western Ghats, stretching from Vindhya to Kanyakumari. In these places, the tribal community are more. That I have said in the previous slide. In the North India, all over the sub-Himalayan region and the Northeast India, the Central India is near the Godavari and the Narmada. It extends from Santhal Parganas in the east to Hyderabad in the south, stretching up to Rajasthan in the west. In the South India, the tribal peoples are concentrated in the Western Ghats, stretching from Vindhyas to Kanyakumari. And the Andaman and Nicobar Island is also renowned for the inhabitation of the tribal people. Now, these are some pictures of the tribal peoples from different parts of India. These are the tribals, nomadic tribes from the Trans-Himalayan region. These are the tribal peoples of different parts of India. And if we go through the indigenous societies of India, we must say that there are over 576 native of tribal communities belonging to 227 ethnic groups. I said it before that nearly 68 million peoples are of tribal communities and 427 tribes of India still maintain a direct relationship with forests. A large number of species are protected by the tribals in the sacred groves. Ethnobotanical studies be based on the indigenous societies in India? The answer is on your screen, because the ethnic people or the indigenous people possess the treasure house of biodiversity knowledge, because biodiversity is a part and parcel of their life and livelihood. Indigenous people share the moments of joys and sorrows with nature. They worship plants, animals, rivers, mountains, and offer flower, fruit, seeds, twigs, leaves to the god. They treat sacred groves as divine abodes. They undergo aesthetic rejuvenation through different seasonal festivals, ceremonies, etc. The indigenous art and craft, paintings, equipments, instruments implicate conservation of bioresources. Now, if we consider the traditional ways of conservation of nature, we must follow some myths. The myths were followed by the ancient people. As for example, a person is honored in Vaikuntha for many years, for as many thousand years as the days he resides in a house where tulsi is grown. That means if we grow tulsi in our house for 10 days, we are going to stay in Vaikuntha for 10,000 years. It's a myth, it's just a myth. But these myths clearly say that the ancient people are saying us to conserve tree, conserve plant resources. Another one is that if one properly grows bilwa means wood apple plant, Agal Marmelus, which pleases Lord Shiva in his family, the goddess of riches, that is Lakshmi, resides permanently and passes on to the sons and grandsons. So if you want to be rich, you must plant bale tree, wood apple tree in your house. The person who plants even a single asattho as per prescribed mode goes to abode of Hori. That means you will go to Swarg, heaven, if you plant a asattho plant. He who has planted Dhatri has performed several sacrifices. He has donated the earth. Dhatri means Amloki, Embelica officinalis. Now it is called Phyllanthus officinalis. He would be considered a celibate forever. He who planted a couple of banyan tree as per prescribed mode would go to the abode of Shiva. So there is a myth. If you plant a couple of banyan tree as per the prescribed mode in our ancient literature, you are going to abode Lord Shiva. You are going to stay with Lord Shiva. After planting neem trees, a person well versed in dharma attains the abode of sun. There are several n number of myths. If you go through the net, you will get several myths and taboos, what you should do and what you should not. And all these are concerned with the conservation of nature. Just let's see. Biodiversity concern of Indian societies can be revealed from idols, motifs and sculptures on temples and other places of worship. The drawing, paintings, pottery, carvings, etc. also reveal the biodiversity concern of the Indian people. We used to offer flowers, fruits, seeds and fragments to the god. We used to worship plants. Several ethnic peoples make tattoos of several plants and animals showing their concern. There are several folklores which are related to conservation of biodiversity, which are related to paying tribute to biodiversity. Several plants are used in ceremonies and festivals. There are several magico-religious practices using plants. There are also some prohibitions and taboos. Now, these are the pictures that show biodiversity concern of the Indian people. These are the tattoos, drawings and paintings. And these are the conservational practices by the ethnic peoples. Now, there are a list of several plants. I picked up some which are conserved in the sacred groves. These plants include Narvilia priniana, which are conserved in the sacred groves of Kerala. Cedarium travancorium, it is also conserved in South Kerala in the sacred grove. Constellaria keraliensis, it's also in Kerala. Antiaris toxicaria, it is conserved in a sacred grove in the Ratnagiri district of Maharashtra. Nema attenuata, it is also conserved in Maharashtra. Vateria indica, it is also conserved in Sivri village in Ratnagiri district of Maharashtra, which is generally a district with higher tribal density. Another one is Prosopis cinerarea, it's conserved in Rajasthan. Vanda quadulia, it's conserved in Tirab district of in Arunachal Pradesh. And we all know that this plant, Nepenthes khasiana, it is conserved in Meghalaya around the Khasi Hills. Another one is Mappia fetida. It is also conserved in the sacred groves of Maharashtra. Now see, one ethnic people, they all are not cutting their trees. They are just using that part of the dried plants that has fall down from the plants, fall down from the trees. They are using the following a sustainable use of forest resource. Now, ethnobotany, that is the direct man-plant relationship, is essential. It ensures optimum sustainable use of bioresources. It ensures food security in the future. It helps in novel drug development, even against dreadful diseases like cancer, diabetes, rheumatoid arthritis. You must have noticed that, you must all know that the ethnic peoples, they had never suffered from arthritis, diabetes, or something, some diseases like that. With the urban people are a common victim of all such diseases. Nearly one in every house suffer from all these diseases, either diabetes or rheumatoid arthritis or osteoarthritis. But the ethnic people, they never suffer from all these diseases. We can detect wild relative of economic plants as a source of gene for developing genetically improved and stress resistant plants, as also disease resistant plants. If we can identify the novel genes from the wild relatives and use our genetic engineering technology, we can incorporate these novel genes to our cultivated plants. Now, discovery of plant sources of diesel. We all know that biodiesel has been recently discovered a few decades ago from verenda plant, Jatropha carcass. We can discover eco-friendly pesticides and insecticides of bio origin. Discovery of more promising, cheaper, and eco-friendly methods of conservation of species can be obtained by following the ethnic knowledge. Now let's consider the strategies for conservation of biodiversity through ethnobotany. So how can we use the indigenous knowledge to conserve our biodiversity? First one is identification of the tribal areas with high density of tribal population. And these places generally exist with a collateral high floristic density and sacred groves. Second thing is a thorough ethnobiological survey in these areas to record the ethnic conservational strategies, what practices these people follow to conserve their surroundings, their ecosystem. To sieve out the scientific rationale, cryptic in ancient folk wisdom and ritualistic attitudes towards nature, and to prepare a database. And the database is, I think, it has been, we all have started for making the database and think the database has been prepared for Bengal. The fourth one is that to have a cross-cultural distillation of values for generating certain ethics for protection of biodiversity. To record the incipient agricultural practices and animal husbandry, what practices they all used to follow for their cultivation and for their animal husbandry. And the last one is to identify and record the wild relatives of the present economic plants and collection of these specimens for ex situ conservation or cryopreservation. There are several economic wild plants. If we can identify all these and collect them, we can use the plants in the future generation. In the future, I think. Now, if we consider the scientific strategies for conservation of biodiversity, in the previous slide, I told about the ethnobiological strategies. Now the scientific strategies. We all are familiar with these strategies. It includes extensive and intensive survey of flora and fauna in wild to identify endangered species. There are several agencies that used to categorize plants to be endangered, critically endangered, vulnerable on the basis of their existence. Second one is documentation and conservation of different grades of plants and animal genetic resources. Third one, formulation of strategies for eco-restoration and in-situ conservation. We all are doing all this that several national parks, reserve forests, protected areas have been constructed and they all are maintaining. Fourth one is to undertake programs for micro-propagation, conal propagation, followed by ex-situ conservation. And the last one is cryopreservation of germplasm. We can conserve biodiversity by applying all these scientific approaches. Now, we can conclude that researches on ethnobotany, that is direct man-plant relationship, and validation of traditional knowledge of India are urgently necessary for sustenance of life, successful conservation of nature, generation of novel genetic resources, and their sustainable use. So conclusively, I want to say that let's do not protect the environment. No need to protect the environment. Rather, let's do one thing, what the ethnic people do. They create a world where the environment does not need any protection. If we can create a world like that, our environment will be automatically conserved. So I would like to thank you all for your patience and listening to me. So if there are any question, you can deliver.
Thank you, Dr. Jagdish Acharya, for such information regarding men and plants. You explained very well about the ethnobotany and the environment. I hope that the deliberation of this webinar is very helpful to the participants. Now, I would like to request Dr. Joyce to select few questions. Over to you, Joyce.
Thank you so much, Dr. Baudi. It was a wonderful presentation by Dr. Acharya. And now we have our interrogative session. A number of questions have been asked by the participants. One is there, which one was asked by Dr. Sanjeev Baudi, that how can we utilize the indigenous knowledge with the modern technology to prevent the COVID-19?
Yes, it's a very interesting question. We all know that our health ministry, WHO, and everyone is saying they all are indulging us to increase our immunity. If we can increase our immunity, then coronavirus, I think we can overcome coronavirus. So the ethnic people and the indigenous knowledge is best concerned with boosting up their immunity. What they all do, their practice builds up immunity from the very, from the very infant stage. Their nurturing of their child, their upbringing makes their child so much immune that they all are resistant not only to COVID-19, but also to several types of diseases, several types of pathogens. So their knowledge, I think we have to practice. We all are trying to practice at present. We all are just taking several herbal products. Nowadays, there are several herbal products we are consuming to increase our immunity. Everyone is consuming tulsi, chyawanprash, and everything like that. If we can, instead of taking all this commercial product, if we share, we can go through their technology, their ethnic technology, and follow their pathway, consume the products used by them, I think it will definitely boost up our immunity and we can fight against not only against COVID, but also to several diseases.
Okay. Thank you, sir. The next question is, what is anthropochory?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Anthropochory is the process by which seeds and plant parts are dispersed by human beings. We, the man, used to disperse several food products. We used to disperse seeds of several plants after consuming the fruits. We used to disperse several plant parts after our consumption. This is called anthropochory. That means dispersal of plant parts by human being.
Okay, thank you, sir. And another one is you have mentioned different slides on the sacred groups. So what are actually the sacred groups, sir?
Okay, sacred group actually are forest fragments. That is a part of a forest which are communally protected. The local people of them protect the forest and have significant religious connotation for the protecting community. All the people who conserve that part of the forest, they have religious faith and belief on that forest. Such forests are called sacred groves. Hunting and lodging, that is felling of trees, cutting trees, are strictly prohibited in such places. There are several sacred groves in India. If you all go through net, you will find several sacred groves. In West Bengal, there are 670 sacred groves. So can you imagine? In Maharashtra, there are 1,600. In Kerala, there are 2,000 sacred groves. And lots of sacred groves in India. Parts of forest which are conserved by the local people on their religious belief.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. It was nice interrogative session we had. Now I call upon our platform, Dr. Tripti Bauri, madam. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Jyoti. Now we are near to end our webinar, and I have an important announcement for the participants. Please fill up the feedback form to get e-certificate smoothly. Feedback link is provided in both our chat box here and in our WhatsApp group. Now it's the time to convey vote of thanks to all, and I handed over this responsibility to Dr. Jayashree Acharya to do so. Over to you, Jayashree.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bauri. It's a great honor and privilege to propose the vote of thanks on this international webinar. On behalf of the committee, first and foremost, we thank our distinguished delegates, Dr. Aparna Banerjee and Dr. Joydeep Acharya, for their valuable contribution in our topic. Despite their busy schedule, it is noteworthy that Dr. Banerjee joined us from another part of the world and completely different time zone. Sincere thanks to all the participants for their presence and keeping their audio mute and video off throughout the speech and support as well. Coming to the organizing committee, we are grateful to our respected principal, Dr. Nipankar Hajra, for his encouragement. His able guidance has always encouraged us. Our heartfelt gratitude to our president, Shri Ram Chakraborty, for his constant support. Thank you, Dr. Tripti Bauri, our convener, for her immense support to make this webinar successful. Our heartfelt gratitude to the IQSC. Our special thanks to Professor Shubrata Kumar Rana for his technical support, starting from the very beginning and throughout this journey to make this event a grand success. Thank you, colleague and non-teaching staff of Kholishani Mahavidyalaya, for their immense support. Now, last but not the least, we thank you, friends, for your kind cooperation in making this function a grand success. And in this pandemic crisis situation, we wish you all good health and prosperity. Thank you once again. Now, I over to you, Dr. Jitsi Gauri, please.
Thank you, Jayashree. I ended this webinar by saying that all of you stay well, healthy, and also happy in this COVID pandemic situation. Goodbye to all. Thank you very much once again.